So I'd like to really start off by highlighting one of the items that Vivian brought up this morning, which is really around the disruption to the legacy business. Digital is not the same as TV. So how do you manage that massive cultural shift across your traditional properties?
I mean, I think that we are less disrupted, actually, at the BBC than I think some other media companies might be. We're very, very diversified internationally, and we operate right across the value chain. So we operate in both the sales of finished programs to multiple platforms. We operate a suite of channels globally. We have our own over-the-top propositions as well. So, you know, it's really about, for us, it's about picking the right market entry strategy for any given market. And so in some markets, you know, in Southeast Asia, where we believe that pay TV might not have necessarily the maturity necessary to beat IPTV or over-the-top, we may choose to skew our content portfolio or our consumer offering in one of those markets, respectively. In more mature markets where, you know, we do have mature pay TV operations, and that would be US, UK, and Australia. You know, it causes tension between the pay TV operators. And it's really about being sensible, I think, at the same time as, you know, we make an enormous amount of revenue from licensing our content to over-the-top providers, and we make a lot of revenue from also our pay TV operators, and I'm going to continue to ride all those horses simultaneously for as long as I possibly can, you know, while at the same time keeping an eye on where I believe the market is moving in the future, and that is probably a mixed, it probably will always be a mixed ecology, but, you know, the ultimate defensible and strategic position is to own both the content and the customer. But you know, there isn't a handbrake turn required to get to that position in mind.
So let me ask a follow-on question, because I'm going to ask each of the panelists to talk about this as well. Former partners are now competitors in terms of developing their own content and obviously having the audience. So how do you handle that transition?
I'm assuming you refer to Netflix.
YouTube.
Well, the great thing about that is, for example, with Hulu, we're a big co-production partner with them. We produce content that goes on Hulu in the US and broadcasts in a premier broadcast window in the UK and other markets. It's an excellent example of, you know, using these new players to actually build great content together, and content that is perhaps slightly different or tweaked for an audience that we know is slightly different online. The same is true for YouTube. We operate a suite of YouTube channels with, you know, hundreds of millions of views across the portfolio. And we have a number of channels that are commissioned by YouTube as part of their initiative. And we're learning how to turn, for example, we are famed for our natural history content, BBC Earth, Frozen Planet, Blue Planet, Planet Earth, and that series, and we have those team of natural history program makers who work out of Bristol in the UK, figuring out how, where they're normally used to $3 to $5 million budgets and 60 minute shows, we're trying to make out how they do it, how they do 3 minute shows, and how they do it 8 times a week. You know, so that, you know, mm-hmm. All of this is an experimentation. Both, as someone said earlier, it's a change in how you change the culture of program making. And also, it's a sort of trying to understand what users and what the audience want from different platforms. You know, I think YouTube, for me, still remains a short-form medium, right? And mm-hmm. we just got to produce high-quality, short-form content that can travel, that is viral for that platform, and that's what we're doing. So mm-hmm. I don't really see them as competitors. I see them as partners in figuring out what the content of the future might look like.
Mm-hmm. Jason?
So let me just start by framing the challenge that PBS has. So PBS primetime lineup, just about every program, Nova, Nature, Frontline, they're all amazing programs. They've all been on the air for more than a quarter century. So huge, and they've been innovating through that time, of course, but, you know, hugely talented, huge, high quality, but not a culture that's used to disrupting itself, or where disrupting yourself internally comes naturally. The framework that we put around when we think about how do we disrupt our business, we think about, and this is really a Clay Christensen framework, we think about sustaining innovations, so innovations that help you with your core existing businesses, and then disruptive innovations where you're actually disrupting your existing businesses. So the results on the sustaining side, well, the things we've done on the sustaining side, a lot of attempts at innovation, some successful, some that bombed. Things like PBS was the first to actually premiere a full-length program on Facebook before it went on television. Same thing on the iPad app, on our iPhone app, we actually premiered programs, and which were, you know, interesting marketing experiments. They had some pretty good results. We integrate interactive games. We take kids' video, linear television video, integrate interactive games. So the results have been great on these sustaining innovations. Last month, Comscore had us as the number one, in terms of uniques, as the number one television network, ahead of even ABC, NBC, CBS.com. You mentioned the video views gone from 2 million to actually 226 million last month. On the kids side, PBSKids.org, 14 months straight as the most popular site for kids video. And in fact, 46% of all minutes spent watching video on kids sites last month was on PBSKids.org. This is scary, 8.4 million hours spent watching video on PBSKids.org. So, you know, really good numbers that we're proud of, but we also know that that's not sufficient. It's necessary to, you know, innovate against your core business, but it's not sufficient. You really need to disrupt yourself. So the path that we've taken in terms of trying to disrupt our traditional approach to television has been, we created PBS Digital Studios about 8 months ago. And Digital Studios is an attempt to, I call it, produce web original video, and the phrase that I use is PBS quality with a YouTube sensibility. And it's sort of hard to describe. We do have a clip. How many of you remember Bob Ross, the guy who taught the joy of painting? Okay, so now this is the guy with the big afro. Let me show you what we did.
Yeah, let's to Bob just Ross. show the clip of that.
Yeah, if you got the clip.
Hello, I'm Bob Ross, and I'd like to welcome you.
I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. Let's build a happy little cloud. Let's build some happy little trees. There are no limits here. You start out by believing here. This is your world. You're the creator. Find freedom on this canvas. Believe that you can do it, cause you can do it, cause you can do it, cause you can do it. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart.
So we auto-tuned Bob Ross, and we actually started by auto-tuning Mr. Rogers. Mm-hmm. And I have to tell you that within the culture of PBS, that was probably not a direction that was, you know, initially embraced when we kind of in a Skunk Works way developed that. So we did Mr. Rogers, we did Bob Ross, we did Julia Child, we did Reading Rainbow.
So what's been the reception now?
Nothing succeeds like success, right? So the PBS Digital Studios in 8 months, we've got about 30, 35 million video views and more than 100,000 comments. So there's been much more of a, internally, you know, people are, there's still, you know, questions from some about how does this align with the PBS brand? How does this, you know, isn't this risky? You know, how do you ensure that everything that you do goes through the quality control that we put television through? And frankly, the answer is, you know, it's a different process, and it has to be much more nimble. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of excitement now around digital studios and a little bit of trepidation with internals.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Yeah, so at Disney, I think one of the things I'm really lucky to have is two leaders of the company who are really forward-thinking and ask us to take risks and set the example and basically set the tone of what they want to see out of the company. So when you look at Bob Iger, who, when he became CEO, was very, very aggressive in terms of promoting digital and technology as the future growth of the company. And then follow that up with Ann Sweeney, who's my boss, who heads the division. You know, she was the one who led the charge on the first iTunes deal in the industry to basically put shows on that. So I had a lot of cultural support. Now, that happened at the top, right at the time when, you know, television was being disrupted. And my job, when Ann sort of tapped me to kind of think about digital within the TV group, she gave me about 6 to 7 months to figure out how to organize it. So, you know, I didn't really officially start my job until like the first week we announced the iTunes deal. But behind the scenes, I was trying to think about how do we set this up without creating the incentives and align it, because I knew that I was going into a situation where the entire company was in a different place, you know, culturally and in a different mindset. So one of the first things I did was to figure out, well, what resources do we need to get digital done? Everything from product development, marketing, a lot of engineers, which at the time had been spread out among a lot of different areas in the company, and pooled those together, business development, and literally basically shaped a mini company that reflected the broader one, but all each coming with a very specific digital background. Then the next thing I tried to do was to make sure the incentives were aligned. So one of the things that, in talking with our finance team, was that in order to keep me accountable, I had to manage a P&L. So a lot of that discussion around managing P&Ls. The issue was I also didn't want to create economic or channel conflict with my traditional cohorts. So the way we set it up was I was going to manage a P&L, which ultimately got folded into the traditional businesses. So even though I had a direct reporting relationship to my boss, I essentially had 5 or 6 different clients. So all the, you know, leaders of the traditional businesses looked at me as grow my digital business, make me profitable, and so I was sort of accountable to all the traditional businesses as well. So that was a way to kind of keep me honest and not overspend and make sure that every piece of money coming into the company was definitely covering the costs and earning a profit on what we do. So I think, you know, that's kind of the formula that we followed. It definitely helps when I have senior leader support. It definitely helps to structure in a way that mirrors the broader company, but also provides the expertise in the digital space. So each of my direct reports, not only are they responsible for managing their divisions, but they are also responsible for being evangelists of digital. So my marketing head literally sits with every network marketing head and tries to educate them on what does digital mean for their business, and they spend a lot of time doing that. And I think that kind of setup has helped us become pretty nimble and also not too wed to a certain model. I mean, we're always paranoid that we're doing the wrong thing, but we try to craft a path and look far out ahead and say, here's what it looks like in 5 years, what are the steps to get there? And I think what we've done is literally take baby steps in building our infrastructure, because it's a huge shock to the system to decide, hey, we're going digital, and all of a sudden expect everyone to be there. We actually had to lay out a 5-year sort of roadmap to say, where do we see the future? And we all kind of bet on multi-screen, multi-platform, IP-delivered video content, you know, had to deal with multiple OSs and the complexity of technology, and then started to work backwards. And working backwards then say, well, what resources do we have? Because mm-hmm. we could not hire that many people. I basically have just a little bit more than what I started with. And so we had to prioritize literally platform development, you know, CMS, all that stuff, little by little, hoping that what we eventually got to was going to meet the market when it was finally there. So I think that's kind of how we dealt with it. And so far, so good. I think we've done fairly well, and hopefully we're going to continue to grow the revenues for the company. I would be remiss not to show a video, because okay. we're a television company. So one of the things that we try to make sure that we tell internally and externally what my team does is literally through the video that I'm about to show you in terms of what we've done so far.
Okay, so this is really the first one, and then we'll go through the multi-screen one.
Yep. when I talk to the team about what our jobs are, it really is about empowering all our stakeholders, and our stakeholders being our consumers, our advertising partners, our distribution partners, and we're always there to, I think, to solve problems that exist, and that's kind of what we're trying to work in the marketplace.
Great.
Great. So being in this room with all of you, I definitely miss the U.S. I moved back to Canada a couple of years ago to run digital for Rogers. Before that, I was running the digital marketing services group of Gannett with Point Roll and Shop Local. But for those of you who don't know Rogers, it's a pretty diverse company, $20 billion company, leading wireless company, cable company, media, all different types of assets, even sports teams, and the QVC of Canada to throw some e-commerce into the mix. So my job's definitely very diverse and fascinating at times. I think I agree with Albert in that it really all starts at the top in terms of how do you think about yourselves as a digital innovation company, as a traditional company trying to shift. Our CEO has been pretty visionary, comes from a wireless technology background, and he really believes that the world is all going IP. So while we still have to focus on how do we capture as much value from the core businesses, they are maturing, and in order to reinvigorate growth and innovate, we've got to be disruptive. So he's been full steam ahead on thinking about what are the areas where we can still really differentiate and win in terms of traditional cable or broadcast and content. So we have a sports business called Sportsnet, which is a much smaller version of ESPN, but across five platforms all the same. And this last year was the first time that the overall company allowed us to actually do a full over-the-top video SVOD offering for Sportsnet World Online. Traditionally, that would have been completely impossible to do with the cable company and so on. But cable subscribers can still get access to it, but for $24.99 a month, any over-the-top consumer can actually subscribe. So that's been a big success for us. A couple others, we haven't produced a ton of digital content ourselves in terms of the video realm, but we've partnered with companies. We've invested in a company called Vugaroo, which is backed by Michael Eisner. We're on the board of that company. We have Canadian rights to all those sort of short-form, medium-form productions that they're doing for $500,000 versus traditional production budgets. So I think the big challenge, though, is how do we scale these new initiatives? And I think it's a common thread we've heard. We can create these great productions, launch digital offerings, but how do you actually get them to scale? And that transition, that secular shift from traditional ad dollars to digital ad dollars, just because that shifting, what we're seeing in Canada is that 60 to 70% of those dollars that are shifting are actually going to Google, Facebook, Twitter, et cetera. So I think where we're spending a lot of time is sort of thinking through how do we structure ourselves organizationally, how do we set up integrated sales teams, how do we try to capture both the integrated dollars and the new sort of emerging RTB and audience-based dollars without letting that slip away, and also diversifying away from just ad revenues. We have a couple hundred million in digital revenues, and it's diversified from advertising, subscription, e-commerce, et cetera. So it's definitely a fun time to be in the industry.
So let's pick up on a comment that you made, that tension between scale efficiency and quality. With digital, quality is paramount. I know with Rogers right now, you guys are reaching about 16 million unique views. That's 65% of Canadians, roughly, online. And how do you deal with that scale problem? Because clearly you want to grow the revenue, but there's massive infrastructure that needs to be in place. And what's that tension between quality, scale, efficiency?
Yeah, it's a great question. It's a tricky one. I think coming from the ad tech world, when I came into Rogers, I was kind of surprised. There's a lot of work to do in terms of the systems and platforms. I won't get into that, but we've made a lot of progress building the foundation. And I think I saw in the early days with Point Roll the shift to programmatic and RTB. We saw it with direct response advertisers first 5 years ago, then brand advertisers. So I think for any of us to stick our heads in the sand and think that shift isn't going to continue and accelerate, I think would be a mistake. I think the tricky part is how do we capture, as someone on the prior panel said, how do we get creative, capture integrated brand dollars, branded entertainment, marketer-driven content is exploding. So how do we structure ourselves to go in with those big ideas, senior level, client direct, et cetera, almost working with agencies and like agencies. But then how do we also try to build some of that scale and efficiency that marketers want? Because the middle ground, as he said, is disappearing fast. And I think a lot of the dollars are shifting away. So a couple things we've done. One, I think we've launched a private exchange in Canada with a couple other key media companies, and it's gone reasonably well so far, still not at the scale we'd like, but we leverage sort of best-of-breed technology from the States with AppNexus, and we're learning a lot, and we're figuring out what sorts of mechanisms work, what sort of data works. Another thing I'd say we're investing very heavily, based on my background, a few people we've hired, we've built out some really strong data analytics and scientist-type teams to build out a full-blown audience intelligence platform. We have amazing data from our owned and operated sites, B2C, B2B, 100 million of e-commerce revenue purchase intent data. We have data from magazine subscriptions. So pulling that all together, figuring out how to best leverage that both for content, you know, advertising, commerce is critical. But I think, you know, so far what we've seen and what I saw over the years is programmatic, it is a very efficient way to buy. The agencies are moving more and more toward that. The shift from creative agencies being more in control of the media is continuing to happen. So the question in my mind is, how do we view programmatic? I think so far it's been looked at as a remnant monetization play for, you know, 50 cents a dollar. I actually look at it more as a buying mechanism. So if we can layer really good data on top of our inventory and present it in some sort of programmatic way at a premium, which we're piloting right now with some of our clients, I think it can be very effective. And you have to balance that with the direct sales team. But I think the key is to think about it as a buying mechanism, try to provide the advertisers with some of that efficiency and reach they're looking for in data and audience targeting, but really stay focused on those integrated creative aspects, because those are the areas where the pure play digital companies, you know, they can't really compete on the full integrated spectrum. How is a consumer consuming content and engaging with your brands across all those platforms?
So, David, for you, there's definitely a trend towards premium content directed at premium advertisers. And we know that even in the YouTube example, a couple of dollars versus $30 to $50 for premium professionally created content. That obviously is a big trend for Disney.
Yeah, you want to answer that one?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, I think not the scale question, right?
Not the scale question.
Okay, different question. So, I think look, there's going to be a lot of, you know, even in the previous panel where there's a lot of demand for high quality, high premium in advertising. You know, I think when it comes to digital, we're going to be asked to do a lot more. I mean, a lot of us talked about how advertisers are wanting more premium branded entertainment. For us, we look at, you know, our core asset is video, and we think that with technology, we can sort of bring a different level or even higher level of engagement. We talked a little bit, that was earlier in the session, it was a little bit about social media and second screen that I think I'm going to talk a little bit about. Well, I mean, we recognize that, you know, second screen and social is definitely driving a lot of activity while people are watching television, and obviously advertisers and brands want to figure out how to get into that. For us, we kind of know that it's happening. We don't attempt to try to aggregate all of that. You know, I think actually, it was Vivian who actually said that, right? So, you know, Zbox is trying to aggregate the social conversation, providing a lot of different things, and we recognize that there are definitely plays like that out there. I mean, Facebook and Twitter are clearly the dominant platforms to talk about social television. So we don't feel that we have anything to add. You know, when we ask the question, what are you going to do in second screen? Well, we can't be Facebook, we can't be Twitter, we can't beat them at that game. So for us, it's about looking at what is it that's core to our content that we can provide that's unique and different. And for us, we were in the third year of our Oscar second screen digital experience. For those who are not aware, it is a multi-screen on any device, Android and iOS this year, where people get a chance to enjoy the Oscar show with a lot of different camera angles. A lot of award shows have done this. We did it with 24 cameras. That probably covered more areas than you ever would want to know, especially.
Well, let's show that clip.
Yeah, sure.
I thought it was fascinating.
It's Oscar time, so let's get ready with the official Oscars app. From nominations morning up to the unprecedented backstage access at the show, we have everything you need to become the ultimate Oscar insider. This is your backstage pass. Here you can get breaking news and exclusive sneak peeks of what's in store for this year's show. The app has everything you need to know about the nominees and also features the official My Picks game, where you can predict the winners and compare scores with your Facebook friends as they are updated in real time. With exclusive videos giving you tips from the pros on Oscar predictions, Oscar party tips, red carpet fashion, previews into the big show, and much more. you'll be ready to enjoy Oscar night like never before. Then on Oscar night, this app gives you a backstage pass to the red carpet and behind the scenes of the 85th Academy Awards, all for free. With over a dozen live backstage and red carpet video streams, you get the best view of the action. It's the perfect companion to have when watching the show on ABC. Call your own shots in direct mode to control what cameras to view. Or if you'd prefer to simply sit back and relax, switch to watch mode as our correspondents take over and guide you through the ultimate Oscar experience. And best of all, with a VIP guest list and millions watching, you can join the party using hashtag Oscars. Oscar season has begun. Start the celebration here with the official Oscars app. Available on iPhone, iPad, Android, and Kindle.
That was a promo video with the footage from last year, but this year we saw an incredible increase, especially on mobile. I mean, a lot more people were watching video streams. It was also great for us financially. From that standpoint, it was over the last 3 years. We made a healthy financial return on that, and Samsung was the partner. And we featured Samsung everywhere. If you were watching the show, even if you're watching the backstage digital, we had Samsung TV monitors, Samsung tablets. During the coverage of the backstage or the secondary experience, literally the entire show was about how social was reacting in terms of who was best dressed. We took a page out of a lot of our colleagues in the industry in terms of how to do a socially driven award show coverage. So that was really one of the things that we felt was creatively good. And I think we're going to see a lot more of that. I think especially when live becomes an even more valuable a part of the television buy, and even in terms of ratings, I think you're going to, if we can start to ratchet up sort of the second screen experience. And one of the things that to know about second screen, it doesn't work for all shows. I think one of the faults we run into is, hey, second screen's great, and second screen for TV is great, but it's not great for every single genre. You know, for award shows like this, where there is the room for viewers to want to leave the main screen to do something else, there's definitely an appetite for that from the viewer standpoint. Definitely for that in breaking news coverage, 24 live coverage. Sports is another one of those types of genres. We tried an experiment with Grey's Anatomy on second screen, and it was the consumer was okay with it, but part of the reason is that consumers, when they're watching scripted shows, want to be watching the scripted shows. There's a story that they want to follow. They do not want to be distracted by audio cues and trivia questions about who looked hot. So that's the thing that we have to be aware of, is that sometimes technology may sound cool, but you kind of have to peel the layer back and understand, well, what are the motivations of what's driving the viewership of a type of program, and does the second screen experience actually add to it and not take away from it? So and that's the hard part about second screen. It's hard to scale because, to scale it, you got to do it for every show on the network. And you're like, I can't do that. And then so when a consumer opens up an app and then looks at it and says, well, only some of the shows have this, what am I doing? And so what happens is you wind up getting a second screen experience that sort of goes down to the lowest common denominator, which is it's all about social, and we decide not to play in that game, and we just want to do very specific experiences like this.
So this was a great example of the necessity of having really a virtual group, because I'm assuming that social at Disney is not part of your team, but you still need to interface with that group to get the full multi-platform experience, including social.
Yeah, I mean, social is interesting because I know David talked a little about how social falls into marketing. It does in terms of how it markets our shows. We do, in our group, use social as content. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit of difference. We do interface with our marketing teams, but we also incorporate, mass relevance, all these companies that you guys use, Bluefin, whatever it might be, to kind of use that social data to then create content. So that is a little bit of a difference.
Yes.
Can I go back to a point that Albert made? Because I think it's a really important one, which is, and Jason agreed, it all begins at the top. So if you want to disrupt your organization, you need support from the CEO and the PBS. Paula Kerger's been amazing. She really gets digital. But that's not sufficient. I think you guys would agree. Because you also need to empower your team to take risks. So, and at PBS, that was not a culture that existed. It was very risk-adverse culture. And in fact, once we got PBS Digital Studios greenlit, the big challenge was the first video that came in was, it looked like kind of mediocre television on a small screen. And I said, what's this? And they were like, well, this is kind of what PBS does, right? And so what we actually had to do a lot of work with the team, things like setting new performance metrics, which included there's going to be a failure metric, and it's a failure metric with a twist. It's if you don't fail enough in the coming years, if you don't fail enough times, you're going to be downgraded because it means you're not taking enough risks. So that's those kind of, and I'd love to hear what other people have done. Always happy to steal ideas. Those kind of prods are really, we found at least in our culture, were really necessary. You need to give people, you need to give your teams freedom to fail.
I think it's been, there's another element to this, which I think is digital has been around in media for quite a long time now. And certainly when I arrived, I felt that the permission wasn't there, 3 years ago, because what you really need to do is take some of those longer plays and drive them to profitability. You need a portfolio of digital businesses on the B2B and the B2C side, and you need to show the company that you're delivering them profit, and then that can buy you some time to go and do some second screen, which you know will come to fruition in 3-4 years, or studios and YouTube. You need a portfolio in digital, right? And I think for too long, digital sat as a P-bit dilutive part of media companies, and that had to be reversed, and that has given us so much more permission.
So you have the benefit of having grown your revenues by 58% from when. So what's happened in terms of providing that ability to do more? Because you saw phenomenal growth in your digital business at BBC.
Yeah, I mean, so we looked at it as a portfolio, and there are mm-hmm. businesses that we've been in for over 10 years, and I expect to be able to take profit out of those businesses, and I expect those to be recurring and greater profits year after year. And then there are things that are going to be there for slightly longer. There's going to be things that we're investing in now, infrastructure for taking video to customers in every country in the world, an audience database to match consumers to content. They will have a longer payback period, but it's about recognizing that you don't need to be at the forefront of innovation on every single part of your digital portfolio. If you are, I think you'll run out of permission pretty quickly.
So let's talk about the innovation, and which relates to customer experience for your digital products. So where do you see yourselves investing over the next 12 to 24 months? Let's start with
sure.
Jason.
Yeah, I think that's a great point in terms of there's a inherent tension around resources and dollars and capital that goes to the core sort of integrated brands versus new growth initiatives. So one thing we did when I came on board was, and it's a tricky one because there's no right answer, I don't think, with regard to centralization or decentralization. We centralized sort of a center of excellence for digital as 300 people. It's focused on digital strategy and innovation, user experience design, platforms, technology, and operating the digital businesses. And I think what we were very clear on was, back to the portfolio approach, how much are we going to allocate to the core businesses and how much are we going to invest in new growth? The other thing I think that's really important is to somehow separate the growth initiatives out from the core P&Ls, because what we all see in these big companies, and it was kind of a little bit surprising for me to go through again, was if there's a tough year, everyone's looking for dollars. If somehow there's not some either protected or separate budget for some of the new initiatives, it gets pulled back pretty quickly. So we set it up in a certain way where we have 3 or 4 main growth themes. We're obviously investing as much as we can in integrated brands and consumer experiences across multiple platforms, but we're betting big on sort of the audience intelligence piece. We're betting big on subscription video on demand and subscription publishing services and ebooks and apps that we heard before, because we have 55 magazine brands, and we're betting big on e-commerce. And I think part of it, we've been fortunate with our asset mix that we don't have to be fully reliant on ad revenue, but so we're taking some big bets, and in some cases we've structured completely separate team, separate budgets, and it seems to be working pretty well so far. The only other point I'd make is, just because we've centralized doesn't mean that all the great ideas come from the digital group. I think a big part of our mandate and what how our success is measured is how we educate, train, enable, seed, and sort of be the catalyst and help. If we see a great idea coming from one of the radio stations or magazines or TV stations, how do we facilitate that, enable that, spark the flame, and then if it works, take it across the other businesses. So I think it's a lot of us, you know, even though there's some good expertise in the center, we have to be really good at educating, training, and sharing that. Because over time, I think digital people should be everywhere, and the brands. And we also have set up a similar P&L structure as to you, where we have a holistic digital P&L, but it's also included in all the traditional business line owners' P&Ls.
Yeah, for us, the headline for us is that we're investing in making a television company behave like a tech company. And what that entails is literally looking at our entire infrastructure, our people infrastructure, to say, what do we need to do to win business and viewership going forward? So when, some of the stuff that you saw in terms of Disney Channel, and we're going to roll that out with ABC and ABC Family, is that all of our networks will eventually be IP delivered. With dynamic ad insertion in both live and on-demand. Actually, it works on the Disney Channel stuff. We just, no one really knows how to sell dynamic ad insertion on live or on-demand yet, but the technology works. So rolling that out and continuing to invest in the infrastructure, big data, all that stuff. One thing I do want to say is that we talk a lot about investing in systems, the business intelligence, and how we're going to get the data analytics all together. What I've been trying to push for internally is that not only do we need to invest in the sort of the hardcore systems, but we also need to have a complete change in people in terms of how to use that data. Because I think you can run into a situation where we spend lots of money on systems, data, we hire a lot of consultants. At the end of the day, the people who analyze the data and can really take that into real business, you know, business action, I don't think exists that much in traditional media companies.
I don't think they exist anywhere.
Right, I would say technology companies are fairly good at that. I think Google's very good at that. We don't have that mindset, and so it's in everything from marketing to CRM to all these functions. I think the challenge is, and the other thing too is, we tend to isolate these functions into the expertise groups, right? So you kind of sit there and go, okay, tell me what I have to do. Or you have research groups that basically say, here's the numbers, here's what's happening. You know, research groups have to get to the point where they can do real-time analysis.
Yep.
But more importantly, we have to hire people within every group, every function, to be able to analyze data.
Right. Data analysts, I would say, are probably the biggest shortage out there.
Right.
Google, I think, probably has hired most of them.
Yeah, probably. So I think that's the biggest thing in terms of, I don't want us to get into the trap of, as long as we spend money in IT and big data, that we're done. It actually, in order to fully maximize that, your entire organization has to be kind of, you know, geared towards what am I looking at? What's the data? And so even on the website side, we try to train people like, look, see what video is doing well, and then how do you react to that in real time? Even my teams aren't quite as good as that. So if my teams aren't as good as that, can you imagine what, you know, traditional marketing teams or, you know, business development teams are looking at?
So.
Mm-hmm. For us, it's all about video, both playing offense and defense. On the defense side, you know, we pride ourselves as, you know, having some of the smartest programming on television, but there's a lot of threats. So there's a program called Minute Physics on YouTube that has just passed 1 million subscribers, so 1 million subs to a program that's essentially, you know, in some ways a knockoff of Nova. So we see a lot of threats in the video side, and also a lot of opportunities. Fortunately, you know, when it comes to investments, what we've learned is that creation of web original video, you know, if you do it in a non-traditional way, it's a fraction of the cost. So you know, and we've got a much different business model from most of you, but we're not really trading, you know, traditional dollars for digital dimes, or if we are, we're offsetting it because the production costs are about, you know, a fifth or less per minute for digital original video. So we're really all in on the video side.
My point of view is that our job is to make sure that our content is distributed to areas that consumers want to consume content. And so when my boss put me in the job in 2005 was to literally transform our digital properties from a marketing function, which at the time a lot of our websites were reporting into marketing, into one that was around content and distribution. Because the goal was to, and my background is in distribution, so you know, I for 5 years at Disney, I helped negotiate cable agreements, and so going into that, I kind of knew what the restrictions were, and also knowing what we had to do to make sure that to sort of basically hedge where we were going, but you know, I will tell you, it was not an easy transition. So here I was, you know, you know, having this mandate to build a digital media business, and the legacy of it being a marketing function consistently hung over the heads of basically the marketing groups. I would actually say the entire company kind of knew we were headed. It's because, you know, Bob and Ann said, here we go, we're going into the digital future. But I think for many years, the marketing groups kept feeling, why is this happening? It should be marketing, and it should drive tune in. Over time, it took a while. It took people leaving for that to happen. And it's now we are at the point where I think it took sort of constant discussions that it's not that there's a benefit for us to be distributing content. I think right now we are at this point, actually as early as maybe 2 years ago, where everyone started to get on the same page. And for whatever reason, the whole industry sort of shifted and realized, okay, yeah, this is going to be very helpful. Where we partner today with marketing to drive the momentum of the show. So we do our form of binge viewing on the full episode player. So Once Upon a Time in Revenge benefited from ratings, return ratings, when we basically, after their first sort of first run on their first season, during the time where there are repeats, we basically said, go catch up. If you haven't seen Once Upon a Time in Revenge, it's on the full episode player, and we literally put all the episodes up for the time being, for that short time. Each of those shows came back with double-digit ratings increases the following time when they had new. So the marketing teams are thinking, you know what, this is, you know, in fact, it was marketing driving programming and scheduling decisions at that point around what was being put on the website. So it was a long haul. You know, I have colleagues here that probably used to work with me also remember the time where it was literally a psychological, cultural struggle to move from a marketing into a distribution and content discussion.
Okay. Yes.
I'm tempted to ask Albert, but I guess I have to spread it around. Maybe everybody could have an opinion about Netflix's decision to put up all 13 episodes of House of Cards and what that means. Obviously, it has a big impact on distribution, so that's why I thought Albert, but I'm sure everybody has an opinion.
I mean, why would they do anything else? I mean, I think for the Netflix audience to have to wait, I mean, the whole thing is built on box set viewing,
right.
You know, all in sort of binge viewing. I think if they had gone the other way around, there would have been an outcry from the subscriber base. I just think it's the natural thing for them to do. I do find it very odd, though, that they have those kind of little it's partly made for television, but partly made for Netflix. I don't know if you've noticed. Why do they have the little recaps? They know that I watched the last 3 episodes 30 seconds ago. I don't need the 10-minute intro.
So it's hard to shed habits, but does that mean that BBC is going to release the British House of Cards next season all at once?
I don't think that's quite the way we work. But you can watch it all at once on Netflix if you like.
Okay, I think that's all the time we have for questions. Thank you, everyone on the panel.